By definition, what makes a quadrilateral a parallel ring? Opposite sides are parallel, right? And then some of the other properties that we talked about, what were they? Opposite angles are congruent. Executive angles are supplementary. Opposite sides are congruent, right? Yeah. What about the diagonals?
So they make two.
Okay, if you draw one of them, it makes two congruent triangles, right? If you draw both of them, what do they do to each other? They bisect each other, which means they intersect each other at the midpoint. And if there's one right angle, there are all right angles. Okay. And so today we're going to work backwards. We're going to say, okay, well, we have this quadrilateral. How can we prove it's a parallelogram? Okay? And so the first way is by the definition. Okay? Somehow we can prove that both pairs of opposite sides are parallel. And that can be done in two different ways. Let's say that one of the diagonals is drawn. Okay? If one of the diagonals is drawn, and we have this information, okay? Knowing this, then remember, I don't know the red arrows are there, okay? This tells me that these two single arcs angles are congruent and the double arc angles are congruent. What kind of angles are those? Alternate interior, right? Okay, alternate interior. These are alternate interior angles. Because remember, you know, I have these two lines cut by a transversal. And so, if these two alternate interior angles are congruent, then I know that those lines are parallel. Same thing here. If these two double arc angles are congruent, then I know those two lines are congruent. Okay? So that would be one way that we can prove that opposite sides are parallel to each other. The other way that we can prove opposite sides are parallel is if we're getting coordinates. When I say getting coordinates, that means you're given your x, y, you know, for each first vertices, okay? And so if I'm given all four coordinates for the vertices, what can I look at to determine that opposite sides are parallel to each other? Well, we know all four of them. We know all four of them. Remember back from chapter 3. What did we look at to determine if two lines were parallel or perpendicular or neither? Their slopes, right? Okay. So we would show opposite sides parallel using their slopes. If the slopes were the same, we know that the lines are parallel. Okay. So that's one way we can prove a parallelogram. Second way, if both pairs of opposite sides with quadrilateral are congruent, then the quadrilateral is parallelogram. Okay? So if they gave us the length and they said this was 6, this was 6, this was 4, and this was 4, that would be enough to determine that this is a parallelogram. Don't know that they're congruent, right? What do we know about all the interior angles? quadrilateral. But it's a parallelogram, the consecutive ones are something. But if we don't know it's a parallelogram, what do we know about the interior angles of a quadrilateral?
Opposites.
They equal 360, right? So I can add all of these up.
This would be 180 plus 60, which is 240.
And then subtract that from 360. Okay? And that would tell me that this was 120. Okay? And so now I can see that my opposite angles are congruent. Probably wouldn't be given one where you use the coordinates to determine that. So we'll leave that one. Okay. If the diagonals of the quadrilateral bisect each other, then the quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Okay? So if we can show that our diagonals, if these links are the same here and these links are the same there, then that would be sufficient to prove it's a parallelogram. What if you were given coordinates? If you were given coordinates, what would you look at to determine that they bisect each other? Yes? Okay, you can use the midpoint formula. So you would find the midpoint of both diagonals, and if that midpoint was the same, then they bisect each other. Okay. So we would show the diagonals have the same midpoint. Okay, and remember midpoint, you add the x's together, divide by two. Add the y's together. You have to do it for both diagonals to show that they were the same. Okay, and in the last way that we can prove that we have a parallelogram, and this way is a little different than any of the other things we talked about. You can pick one pair of sides. And if you can show that those sides are parallel and congruent, then you can say that it's a parallelogram. Okay? So show that one pair of opposite sides is congruent and in parallel and have the sufficient. And so if you were getting coordinates, what would we have to use? What two things we have to use? Distance and slope, right? Distance and slope. So you would have to show one pair of sides congruent using distance and parallel using slope. I can use both of those for one pair of opposite sides. Okay, so here's a little proof. I'm not going to do a lot of proofs because we'll go ahead and do this one together. I am given that these two triangles here are congruent to each other. And I want to prove that ABC is a parallelogram. Alright, so if I know that these two triangles are congruent, what can I get from that? What can we get from the fact we have congruent triangles? Okay, all the sides are congruent, right? And what allows us to say that? Congruent triangles have congruent parts, right? What do we use to represent that? Do we have a little acronym? Right? Corresponding parts of congruent triangles are congruent. So if these two triangles are congruent, all the corresponding parts are. So I can say that these two sides were congruent. And I can say that those two sides were congruent. And that would be by CQCTC. Well, if my opposite sides are congruent, like I have marked, then what's true about ABCD? Parallelogram, right? Because the opposite sides are congruent, isn't it a parallelogram? Okay. Good. So that was the proof there. So triangle ABD is congruent to triangle CDB. That's given. Because those two triangles are congruent, we can say that BC is congruent to DA. And we can say that BA congruent to BC. What was my reason for that? CQCTC, right? Corresponding parts of congruent triangles are congruent. Alright. And so now I've established that my opposite side points. Well, they show you a picture, and you determine if there's enough information to determine if it is a parallel grid. Well, if I look at this first one, is that enough information to prove that I have a parallel grid? And what would my reason be? How do I know? Okay, these pair of opposite sides are congruent, right? Okay, but I need something else that just shows that one pair of opposite sides is congruent. It's not enough. Okay, these two angles here are supplementary, right? And so if these are supplementary, what does that tell me? Well, look at this. See, it had two lines cut by a transversal. And these are consecutive interior angles. And if you have consecutive interior angles that are supplementary, what does it tell you about these lines? If they're parallel to each other. Okay. So, not only are they congruent, but they're also parallel. Okay, and that goes back to that last reason that we learned. If you have one pair of opposite sides, both parallel and congruent, then you have a parallel grid. So the answer would be one pair of opposite sides are both parallel and congruent. Therefore, FGHJ is a parallelogram. When it says justify, like this one says justify your answer, you give the reason why you're able to prove that it's a parallelogram. This one, you had one pair of opposite sides for parallel congruent. Okay, look at the next one. Someone liked this a little bit already. I know that these are both 115, and I know that angle A is 65, but I've got to figure out what angle C is. I can't just automatically say that it's 65. I need to test it, right? And what do we know about all the angles of A quadrilateral? So if I say 360, this is 230 plus 65. 295, and that would be 65. Okay, so is this a parallelogram? Yes, what? Think about parallel. I know that opposite angles are congruent. So, since opposite angles are congruent, is a parallelogram. I guess you could say that the opposite sides were parallel because what do we see about the consecutive interior angles? 115 and 65, that's supplementary, right? This is supplementary, that's supplementary, all the way around, right? So you could say opposite sides were parallel. Okay, what about C? I have one pair of opposite angles congruent. I don't know necessarily that these are, though. I know that everything has to add up to equal 360, but I don't know necessarily that these are the same, right? And then I know that these two sides, ES and QR, are congruent. But do I have enough information to determine if they're parallel? No. So is there enough information? Okay. So there's not enough info. Therefore, PQRS is not a parallelogram. Okay, if you're going to have some problems like this, and it's going to say, okay, find x and y so that each quadrilateral is a parallelogram. So I've got to figure out what x and y need to be in order to make this a parallelogram. What's going to have to be true here for this to be a parallelogram? Six x minus 12 is going to have to be equal to 2x plus 36, and 4y is going to have to be equal to 6y minus 42. So my opposite sides are going to have to be congruent in order for this to be a parallelogram. So now I have to figure out what x and y need to be in order for that to happen. So I subtract 2x, that gives me 4x, add 12, equals 48. Divide both sides by 4, and x is 12. divide both sides by -2, and y is 21. So x is 12 and y is 21. EFG is a parallel. Okay, what's going to have to happen here? Y is going to have to be equal to 2y plus 12, and x is going to have to be equal to 5x minus 28. So what does that establish? The diagonals have the same midpoint, but they bisect each other. Okay? So I'm going to subtract 2y from both sides. That gives me 3y equals 12, and so y is 4. And then subtract 5x from both sides. That gives me negative 4x equals negative 28. So x is going to be 7. So if y is 4 and x is 7, RST2 is a parallel. All right. Now, on these, you have to use the method that they tell you to use, okay? It's to determine whether the figure with given vertices is a parallelogram. You use the method. So what they want us to do is they want us to use slope, okay? So if they want us to use slope, they wanted us to show that the opposite sides are parallel. Now, you could do one of two things. You could graph it, and you could count the slopes, because what is slope when you graph it? Rise over run, okay? So if it's already graphed, you can look at the slope of the opposite sides and determine if they're the same, okay? So if I looked at AB, you rise one and run back 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's negative 1/5. Here I rise one, go back 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's negative 1/5. So those are parallel. Then I look at the slope of AD and BC. You rise 3 and run 2. You rise 3 and run 2. So in graphing it, I was able to determine that the opposite sides were parallel, correct? Now, people just don't want to graph. That's fine. So you could use the slope formula, yes? So if I did that, I would have to look at the slope of AB, and I would have to look at the slope of BC. And the slope of AB would be 3 minus 2 over 3 minus 8. That's a negative 1/5. And then DC would be 0 minus a negative 1 over 1 minus 6. So that's a negative 1/5. Okay? So that tells me that AB is parallel to BC. Then I would look at the slope of AB and the slope of BC. And again, I would use my formula, 3 minus 0 over 3 minus 1, that's 3 over 2, and 2 minus a negative 1, which is 2 plus 1, over 8 minus 6, which is 3 over 2. So that tells me that AB is parallel to BC. In either case, however you do it, I can see that opposite sides are parallel, therefore ABCD is a parallel. Graph it and count, or you can just use the formula if you don't want to graph it. Do both, I don't care. Okay. All right. Now, in this one, it says use distance and slope. So which one of the theorems are we working with then if we have to use distance and slope? Okay. If one pair of opposite sides is both parallel and congruent. Okay? So you're going to pick a pair of sides. Pick SP and RQ. And I have to show that they have the same slope, and I have to show that they have the same length. Okay? So if I count it, you can use the slope formula, whichever way you want to use, I don't do both this time. But I rise 1, 2, 3, 4, and I run 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's negative 4, 7. Here I rise 1, 2, 3, 4, run 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's a negative 47, okay? So that tells me that SP is parallel to RQ. remember that is x2 minus x1 quantum squared and y2 plus y2 minus y1 quantum squared. So I've got to look at sp, and that would be negative 2 minus 5 quantum squared plus 7 minus 3 quantum squared. It's negative 7 squared plus 4 squared, which is 49. So, what were the five ways to prove a parallelogram? Opposite sides are congruent. Or opposite angles congruent. What about else about opposite sides? They are parallel. Okay. What's another way? They have the same midpoint. The diagonals have to have the same midpoint. They bisect each other. Okay. And the last one?
One pair of sides.
One pair of sides parallel.